Dear participants, for our last session in this FDP, we have our eminent colleague from NITTR itself, Dr. C. Ramakrishna. Dr. Ramakrishna received his B.Tech from JNTU, Anantapur, M.Tech from Cochin University of Science and Technology, and he is a PhD from IIT Kharagpur. A senior professional, he is a senior member of IEEE US Fellow IIT, and since 1996 he has been working with the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at NITTR Chandigarh. Currently, besides being a professor in the department, he is also Associate Dean Product Development. He was heading the CSE department for about 4 years, and he has more than 24 years of teaching and research experience. He's a very, very prolific trainer, has more than 130 training programs to his credit, both in online and offline mode. And besides CSE and IT, his other focus areas to improve the quality of technical education in India. He's had so many other credits to, which within the institute, that is NITTR, he was in charge of campus for Internet Administration Institute web portal, NCTEL, which is an online resource portal for video lectures which are recorded in NITTR, and so many other things. And he is also responsible for preparing the institute for accreditation of the M.Tech program being run by NITTR. Besides his research interests include networks, wireless networks, cryptography, cybersecurity, cloud computing, etc. He's also published more than 110 research publications in quality journals and conferences, as well as he's a member in the advisory and technical committee of many national and international journals and conferences. He's chaired so many sessions, delivered invited talks both in India and abroad. He's organized 4 international conferences, carried out several sponsored projects, guided 85 masters and 9 PhDs. He's a reviewer of elsewhere, IEEE, Springer, ACM. He's got 3 patents published and 1 copyright to his credit. And he's visited several countries in pursuit of his academic activities. More pertinently, in looking at this course, he's a member of the expert committee NIRF MHRD since 2015 when this thing was started. He's carried out several UGPG accreditations as an expert member under NBA. So under his leadership, his own department, CSE, was also accredited for the full 5-year term. And he was a committee member with the AICTE to bring about examination reforms in technical education. He's also certified accreditor of the Asia Pacific Accreditation Certification Commission, Manila. And he's also done accreditation work under this in Malaysia. His impact in terms of research is enormous, and in terms of a leader in technical education, a leader in quality education,
I think
we can start. I think what he has to say, he has already told. Thank you, Professor Gill, for the nice introduction. And it is a very smart system, right? It knew that where it has to cut off the internet connection. Very smart system, right? Because he has read the last word and then immediately, automatically got cut. Right, Gilsav, I think you can unmute and then say it. Yeah. Sir, you want to say something?
No, sir. You're welcome to start our session. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for the nice words that you have told about me. I have only a little experience, right? Gained not in overnight, maybe over a period of 25 years working in this institute. I am fortunate that Dr. Balwinder has given me an opportunity to interact with you all. on evaluation guidelines when the actual visit happens. Actual visit happens by the NBA expert team, three-day visit, right? So I'll show you the evaluation guidelines. So specifically, I'm not prepared any presentation purposefully. I thought that let me take the original document of NBA itself. And then it's a huge topic, right? 1.5 hour, I will not be able to do justice, but yes, whatever is possible in 1.5 hour, I'll try to highlight the important ones. And then maybe we can have a discussion for 10, 15 minutes at the end of the session. So hope I have the presentation rights, Dr. Balwinder.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so is this screen is visible, Dr. Balwinder?
Yes, sir, it is visible. Yes.
Do I need to zoom it further? The zooming is required?
Sir, if possible, kindly zoom it.
Is this fine now?
It's better than earlier, sir, if possible.
What about this?
Yeah, sir, it's okay. Right okay. Now, it's okay.
That's great. Yeah.
You can click on this hide button on the screen.
Yeah, okay, right. Right. So good morning all the participants, and first of all I congratulate you, right, because you have taken a right course, which is the need, right? Even AICT is insisting upon, UGC is insisting upon, right, going for accreditation, and Government of India, Ministry of Education is also insisting that by 2022 or 23, right, 50% of the programs in the entire country, engineering programs, should be accredited. So because of the pandemic, there are some delays. It is an unforeseen circumstance. But definitely the need of the hour is, if it's not 2023, by 2025 or 26, right? The government is expecting that to improve the quality in technical education, you should follow this outcome-based education model. Right, follow the good practices that have been covered in the last 4 days by the several experts that I have seen the timetable. So once you start doing the practices of outcome-based education, I am 100% sure that accreditation is a byproduct of it, right? It is not that you are preparing for accreditation. You follow the set quality norms, and then automatically, right, you will be able to get this accreditation in a very easy way, right? Maybe 3 years or 6 years and so on. So with these few words, I'll start my this thing. This is the document prepared by NBA itself, right? And it is available on the NBA portal, nbaind.org. Otherwise, also, it's a very useful website. There are a lot of resources are available, those who are not familiar. So you can visit nbaind.org and you get this document. If you are not able to get it, I'll share it with Dr. Balwinder. We will share it with you. So if you look at this document, it is a 26-page document, evaluation guidelines for the experts who are coming to the institution to evaluate for the purpose of accreditation, right? Whatever you have claimed in your pre-qualifiers, whatever you have claimed in your self-assessment report, that you have uploaded on the NBA portal. So that is shared with the experts also, your pre-qualifiers, your complete self-assessment report. The soft copy has been already shared with the experts, and they might have gone through it before they actually arrive at your institute. So basically the visit is just to verify the claims that you have made in the self-assessment report. And then based on the verification of documents, physical visit, right? Physical visit, viewing certain facilities. So based on these evaluation guidelines, experts will be evaluating your SAR and then try to come up with a score, or maybe come up with some sort of evaluation parameters. Like if it is a tier one system, they will be having a full compliance or right, they have concerns, they have weaknesses, they have deficiencies, right? If it is a tier two system, it is purely based on the marks, right? Marks out of 1,000, right? Whether you are getting 750 plus, or whether you are getting 600 to 750, right? Or you are getting below 600, right? Below 600, we all know that in a tier two system, you are not going to be qualified for accreditation. after the visit, right? If you're getting between 600 and 750, then you will get it for 3 years. If it is more than 750, you will be recommended for 6 years. So this NBA expert team, which is visiting your institute, they make the recommendations, right? Based on the various documents that you have presented before them, various facilities that they have seen, right? So they will make the scores, and then it is recommended to the NBA. NBA has a other process, right? They have two, three committees which will go through all these reports, and then final decision will be taken by the NBA. So what I mean to say is, final decision is not in the hands of the experts, right? But yes, definitely their inputs are the major things to have come up with a final decision by the NBA. So very, very important thing. So I have highlighted certain things in the yellow color, right? And I'll be more focusing on those things which need some explanation. Rest of the things are self-explanatory, so that I am not going to touch upon those things. The first criteria, that is criteria one, is vision, mission, and program educational objectives. It is carrying 50 marks, right? 50 marks. And I have seen that any institution which is running for last several years, right? So in this criteria, I have seen people getting around, 30 to 40 marks, right? 30 to 40 marks easily, right? If you have maintained all the documents, proper documents, like suppose you have defined your vision statement, you have defined your mission statements, you have formulated your program educational objectives, a proper procedure has been followed, how you have come up with these statements, right? So if you have that, and I have seen the institutions getting even 40 marks also out of 50, right? 40, even 42 also, I have seen some one or two cases, right? Otherwise, usually this is a criteria where you will get it if your institute is already running for most last several years, okay? So 1.1 state the vision.
Excuse me, sir. Voice is not clear, sir.
Yes.
Voice is not. Audio is not clear, sir.
No, sir. It's clear. Dear participants, it's clear on our side. So kindly check your connection. It is crystal clear.
So dear participant, maybe you may disconnect and join again. There may be a bandwidth issue at your end also. So I suggest that you can disconnect and connect it again, right? If other participants are also saying, then I will disconnect and connect it again. Balvinder, you are getting it clearly, right?
No, sir. All the participants who are not able to see the screen, go to the participants tab and click on the presentation by the name of Rama, sir, or either you can reconnect.
Okay.
Please continue, sir.
Thank you. So state the vision, mission of the department as well as the institute. So when you prepare this vision and mission for the institute, you will also be preparing for your own department, right? So whatever you prepare for your department, because department is a subset of the whole institute. So your vision statement of the department, your mission statements of the department should be aligned with the institute vision and mission statements. That means whichever direction institute is moving, the department also should be helping, right? To move with the vision and mission of the institute. So very important. That's why I have written here, consistency of the department statements with the institute statements, right? Some institutions I have seen that institute vision and mission is moving in one direction and the department is not fully moving in that direction. So then you lose these marks, right? Though there are only 2 marks here out of 5, right, for this 1.1, but every mark will count. Every mark will count, right? Because I have seen institutions, right, they could not get accreditation because they fall short by, let us say, 5 marks or 10 marks, right? They were supposed to get 600 marks in tier 2 system, but they got, let us say, 590 marks or 595 also. I have seen some cases even they are stopped at 595, okay? Even there are institutions which has got 610 got rejected, right? So maybe because I told you that whatever is submitted by the experts, that will be thoroughly evaluated by the NBA, maybe one or two committees are there. They will also evaluate all these things properly, right? So every mark counts. Don't take it that this is only 2 marks, I have not done it, so no problem, right? So every mark counts and you should be very serious about it, and you should have proper things should be written, right? That's what I wanted to say. So consistency is very, very important when you are making your department vision and mission. Keep in mind your institute vision and mission statements, very important. State the program educational objectives, right? So anyway, this you will be giving it the list definitely. But later on, they will be asking for the documentary evidences also. What is the process that you have adopted when you have defined this program educational objectives? Okay. So availability and correctness of the PEO statements is very, very important. So you have statements, but in some institutions, I have seen that they are so casual. There are some mistakes, right, in the PEO statements. Sometimes there are some spelling mistakes are there. Sometimes the sentence is not clear what they have written. So that shows to the experts that they are very casual while defining this program educational object. So you should be very serious, right? And you have revised your statements. You have gone through it properly, right? And then other thing I wanted to say that whatever vision, mission, PEO statements that you have made, you have finalized, that should be exactly available on your web portal also, right? For the benefit of the other stakeholders. So experts also, before they actually visit your campus, they have the soft copy or SAR, soft copy or pre-qualifiers, and then they have only option is to verify from the website certain things, right? So I have seen in some of the cases that the document that I have received, SAR and pre-qualifiers, and what is shown on the website, right? Maybe website is not updated at all. So now the experts will think that which one is right, what the document has come or what is available in the website. So you see that your website is an interface, right? Not only for the expert, for the entire stakeholders of your educational system. So you should keep on updating your website with the current information. Very, very important. So in the case of 1.3, indicate where and how, that's what I'm telling you, indicate where and how the vision, mission and PEOs are published and disseminated among stakeholders, right? So you have various stakeholders, starting from your students, your own faculty, then you have your employers, then you have your parents, right? Then you have some other important regulatory authorities like AICD or UGC or whatever it is. So it is your responsibility to disseminate all these statements that you have defined. Very, very important, right? So adequacy in respect of publication and dissemination, there are some marks out of 15, 3 marks are given to that. Right. And then one of the important thing is extent of awareness of vision, mission and PEO statements among the stakeholders. So this point will be checked by the experts when they actually visit your campus, when they interact with the various stakeholders. Like, for example, when I go for a CSE program, right, BTEC CSE program or MTEC CSE program. So as a part of the schedule, I am supposed to interact with the students, right? So if it is a BTEC program, we interact with the final year students, we may interact with the third year students, second year students also. So we check it, like, whether they are aware of what is the vision of this institute, what is the vision of this department, right? Okay, are they aware of what are these program educational objectives that the department has defined? Okay, so if the no students are speaking, right, no students are able to understand the questions that are being put by the experts, that understand that though you have defined these statements, but it has not reached to the stakeholders, right? So there are 9 marks out of 15, it's a good number, right? Good number. So straight away, right, you may lose a lot of marks in this. If the your students and other stakeholders, like parents are there, even employers are there, right, they're not able to say anything about it. Okay, so very, 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 very. So that's what you can see here, extent of awareness based on the interaction with the internal and external stakeholders, right? So there is a meeting with the parents, there is a meeting with the employer, there is a meeting with the students, there is a meeting with the faculty also. Even many times I have seen astonished, right? Even the faculty is not aware of what are the program educational objectives, who has defined these PEOs. So very, very important. So this all carries important, right? Because it is very important when you want to take the department along, when you want to succeed, right, with the vision, mission and all those things. So every stakeholder, that is every faculty, every student should be made aware of this entire system, why you are defining all these statements, what is the purpose behind it, how they are going to be part of this, so that we will be able to achieve it in the next 5 years or 10 years or 15 years and so on and so forth, right? So 1.4 is state the process for defining the vision and mission of the department and PEOs. That's what I was telling you, right? You have defined definitely certain statement, then what is the process that you have adopted? What is the documentary evidence for those things, right? So you can see here, documentary evidence to indicate the process which ensures effective participation of internal and external department stakeholders with effective process implementation. That means when, suppose, let us say you have defined PEO statements. Okay. So you prepared a draft document, maybe with the help of students and faculty of the department, they brainstormed and then they came up with the draft PEO statements. Then you have some external stakeholders, like suppose you invited some industry expert, you invited some reputed academic institution experts also, right? And then you have presented these PEO statements and then you took input from them, or maybe you have sent it to your alumni also right? And then you have invited them maybe for online meeting, and then with the help of them also, finally you finalize it. So where is the documentary evidence of all those meetings, right? When is the first meeting held? When was the draft was prepared? Who was the part of this draft preparation? Then how, when the meeting has been held with the help of the external stakeholders, right? And what was the agenda of that meeting? And what are the comments of the experts? Then how you have incorporated all those things. So that document, just like in a government office, you have a systematic way of maintaining files, right? With all the necessary documents. You can have a soft copy also, you can have a hard copy also, whichever you feel comfortable, which you can demonstrate to the experts. So you can maintain a system, online system also, where you can demonstrate to the experts, or you can have a physical files also as per your convenience. Very, very important. Is establish consistency of PEOs with the mission of the department, right? So you have a vision for the department. To achieve that vision, you have few mission statements, right? So you need to have a mapping between program educational objectives and the mission statements of your department. That means a matrix have to be made, and along with that you need to justify, right? Matrix matlab, right? You will make one side your PEOs are there, other side right, you have your mission statements. So PEO 1 is mapped to mission statement 1 and mission statement 5, not to 2, 3, 4, let us say, right? PEO 2, right, is mapped with maybe 2, 3, but not with other mission statements. So you need to justify why they are not mapped, or why they are mapped with a strong correlation. So that justification also, if you can give it, that is going to be very good. That means everything is well thought about. It is not that simply you put the numbers 1, 2, 3, right, in the matrix. But every one, every two, every three that you have entered, there is a justification. Why they are strongly correlated, why they are having a low correlation. So those things you need to have a justification. So this 1.1 to 1.5 completes this first criteria of vision, mission, and the PEOs, right? Okay, so any query you have on this criteria number one, right? So we can take up, otherwise we'll go to criteria number two, right? Yeah, any questions you have? So Balwinder, is there any query in the chat window? Because I'm not able to see the chat window, because then I have to come out of this.
No, sir.
Okay, right. So we'll go ahead. We can take your questions at the end also. There is no issues. Right. Criteria number two is program curriculum and teaching learning processes. So very important criteria, particularly for all the faculty, right? Because that is the reason that we are existing in our institutions. So teaching learning process lies with the faculty, definitely along with the students. Then the curriculum that you have defined, if you are a tier one institution, program curriculum is a very serious aspect. If it is a tier two institution, so you don't have much control, you have to depend on the university, affiliating university. So you may not be very seriously looked at it at the program curriculum, because you are just following what the university has prepared. But the teaching learning process is unique to each of the institutions, what type of practices you are following, and then how it is providing effectiveness in terms of the students learning. State the process for designing the program curriculum, right? Anyway, definitely if your institution is running, your department programs are running, so you have a curriculum. So why I have highlighted the, also consider the involvement of the industry experts, particularly for the tier one institutions, right? Tier one institutions. So who are the industry experts who have participated in your board of studies meeting? Right. So you have an agenda for the board of studies, right? You have a draft curriculum that you have prepared. What are the inputs that you have got it from the industry experts? What are the inputs that you have got it from the other academic eminent institution experts, right? And how are you going to incorporate? For tier two institutions, right, you can always call the industry expert, because they're also recruiting your students, right? You can call some of the employers and then take their inputs, right? Suppose it is not part of the curriculum, which is defined by the university. How you are going to incorporate those things which are needed for the students, right, placement point of view or a higher studies point of view, which the industry experts have recommended. So that means apart from the curriculum, you can also have certain things which you can incorporate on your own as an institution, as a department. Okay, so documentary evidence is very, very important. The way that you have defined your program curriculum, okay, very, very important. So rest, I am the structure of the curriculum. I am not talking, because that's self-explanatory. Very important is state the process used to identify the extents of the compliance of the curriculum for attaining the program outcomes and program specific outcome. That means whatever curriculum that you have defined, let us say it is a BTEC program, you have four semesters. Out of the four semesters, first year you remove it, because first year maybe one or two subjects only will be there from the department, maybe programming or something like that. but let us say second, third, and final year. Because when you look at the evaluation also, first year evaluation is separate, right? That is a criteria number 8 will take care of first year academic separately. So that you have to focus as a department on second year, third year, and final year. So you have 6 subjects or 5 subjects in a semester, right? In a year, you have maybe around 10 or 12, and 3 years, around 30 to 35 subjects will be there, which is in your control, right? How these subjects, right, which are part of the curriculum, are going to satisfy these program outcomes and program specific outcomes. And that you will see in criteria number 3, right? You will be developing this for every subject, you have COs, right? And then the COs are mapped with the POs and PSOs, right? All those metrics that you have to create, articulation metrics, you need to create it. That has been already covered by the experts. So that shows clearly that how the entire curriculum is mapped, right? The entire curriculum is mapped with the help of to the POs and PSOs, and the documentary evidence, and how exactly you have mapped it, and what is the justification, right? How you put those numbers, right? 1, 2, 3, and all those things that you need to have a justification. Okay. Describe the process followed to improve the quality of teaching learning, right? So all these things we are doing it, adherence to academic calendar, right? If you are a tier 2 institution, university has given the calendar, and most of the institutions I have seen that they are following the academic calendar, so they'll get 2 out of 2. There is no need. Pedagogical initiatives, right? Anything new you are doing it, if you can highlight it before the experts and then convince them that what are the impacts that new pedagogical initiative that you have taken is impacting the students' performance, that is excellent, right? Very important is support the weak students and encourage the bright students. That's what I have highlighted here also. Guidelines to identify weak and bright students, right? And then one is identification. Other one is what you have done after identify, post-identification actions taken. And then after you have done something for weak students and the bright students, what is the impact? What is the impact, right? So in some of the institutions, I have seen that they have identified weak and bright students. Some activities they have done, but there is no impact study. There is no impact study, right? So you will get definitely a few marks, but your loop is not complete, right? You have identified, you have done something, but you have not observed the impact of it. And then why you have to see the analysis of this impact is, then you will be able to know whatever you are doing the activities, whether it is sufficient for the weak students and the bright students or not. If it is not sufficient, then you have to again come back and then see what are the other activities that you can take care for the weak students and the bright students. So it is a continuous process, right? It is not one way that you just identify in one semester or something like that and leave it, right? It's going to be a continuous process among all the years of the students, second year, third year, and final year in each of the semesters, right? And then efforts to keep students engaged, right? Also to be verified during interaction with the students. So what type of activities you are giving, like assignments you are giving, mini projects you are giving, right? Major projects you are giving, right? So what type of activities that you are giving so that the students are engaged fruitfully and there is a learning, they're gaining the competencies all through all these activities. Very, very important. Then quality of laboratory experience with respect to conducting, recording observations, analysis, etc. So here I wanted to say that what I have experienced in many of the institutions is, right, when we take this lab record or lab files, right, in South they call it as record, in Northern side they call it as lab file. So when we randomly take the files of the students, right, lab files or lab records, we find that there are, let us say, 10 experiments have been carried out, right, in the index page, right, you can say that maybe the 5 experiments are checked by the teacher in one go. Right, other 5 we have checked in another go, right, and then some grades or marks are written there out of 10 each experiment. So sometimes they have given 10 out of 10, sometimes they have given 6 out of 10, sometimes they have given 8 out of 10. Then I was curious to see that why they are given only 6 out of 10. So I went to that particular page and I found that every page is having only tick mark, no comments are written, but the marks are reduced. So then we asked the teacher why there are no comments here. Right, every page is having tick mark, and then for your information, I have seen some of the places that even the empty page is also having red tick mark, empty page also. So I was on a lighter note, I was telling the teachers, it appears that you have given this lab record for checking, right, to tell them that put tick mark everywhere. So that person has put the tick mark on the empty page also, right? So it appears that there is no proper evaluation is done, right? So what I wanted to tell you is your comments are very important for the students. Right? Why you need to give this comment is they will improve for the next experiment at least, right? So let us say experiment number 1 itself, that fellow has got 6 marks out of 10. So he has done some mistakes. but you have put all the tick marks and reduce the marks, no comments are there. So experiment number 2 and 3 also you may do the same mistakes. If he's not intelligent student and serious student, nahi hai, 2, 3, every experiment also you will do the same mistakes, which are there only with you, but you are not written anywhere. So the purpose is to convey why the marks are reduced to the students. So when we ask this question, the teacher says that, sir, in the lab session when it is going on, they have a rough file also. In the rough file, sir, it is given to them. So what I am saying is, then you show the rough file to me. But they don't have the rough file. They could not show it, right? They could not show it. So whether it is a rough file, whether it is a final file, the comment should be written somewhere and that should be conveyed. That is the whole purpose of it. So that students will learn that what are the mistakes they are doing and how they have to improve. That is a whole exercise, right? That is a whole process. Okay. Then internal semester examination, internal marks, there are practical record books, right? And then experiment assessment, final marks, right? Assessment of all the experiments and other assessments. Very, very important that you need to have a record of all those things, right? Maybe the entire record, and then some samples also you can keep, because you can't keep all the lab files or lab records of the last 3 years, but you can always keep some of the best student records, average student records, and the poor student records, right? So you should be able to justify also why this student is best, why this student is average, why this student is weak, right? On what basis you have categorized them, and what are the steps that you have taken to make these weak students to the average students and average students to the bright students, right? Something like that. So you can, you should be able to justify it. Very important is, it is not only for this criteria, for all the criteria, right? Wherever it is applicable, feedback, right? Whatever feedback you are taking, what is the frequency of that feedback? Whether you are taking semester wise, whether you are taking for every subject in the semester, whether you are taking in a year wise, right? If it is taken, what is the analysis that you have carried out? When the analysis is taken out, what are the strengths? What are the weaknesses? What are the areas of concern that you have identified? And what are the actions that you have taken? Once actions you have taken, what is the impact of this action, right? Analyze it again and then try to improve it, this feedback system. But many a times I have seen that feedback is taken, some extent analysis is done, right? Some actions are taken, but it is not complete, right? So try to do it, right? When you start this process of accreditation, in the first year, you may not be perfect, but the second year, definitely, right, you should be better than the first year. In the third year, right, you should be much better than the first 2 years. And similarly, if you are practicing this for the last 6 years, so your system should have come to a stage where it is going more towards quality and perfection sides. So that is expectation that you should be able to demonstrate to the experts who are visiting your particular program, right? Sir, first year we have done like this. So these are the things we could not do it in the first year. These are the things we have done it. And second year we have improved like this. Third year we have improved. And then this is the impact that we are observing over a period of last 3 years, right? And we are continuously trying to improve upon it. That's what they wanted to see. Quality of end semester examination, internal semester question papers, assignments, and evaluation. For the tier one system, everything is going to be checked thoroughly because you have the complete control on all these question papers, internal, external, everything. For tier two systems, yes, you don't have control on the end semester examination paper, but definitely, yes, internal assessments, you have the control. So you should be able to demonstrate through the question paper, through the assignments, which are under your control, right? So you should be able to convince the experts with the help of this. Okay. Then quality of the student projects, very, very important, right? Which is very important for the students to gain the skills along with the knowledge. Types and relevance of projects and their contribution, right? I have seen in some institutions, last 3 years, same projects are given, right? Same projects are given. So in some of the places, right, even I am also a teacher like you. So I have seen students even submitting their photocopy wala projects, right? Because the same project is given this year also, same project is given next year also. So students are very smart, right? They don't have time also these days. So photocopy facilities available, copy paste facilities available. So they are coming up with the same report, right? Without even doing it also, right? So you are not supposed to encourage these type of things. That means your faculty should have sufficient number of problems, right? That can be given to the students, right? The students can be guided in that direction. So the students are excited to carry out these projects, right? And which will definitely, right, you are doing it so that attainment of POs and program specific outcomes are done. Is there any lab related to project lab related to the industry, right? That means there are some emerging areas are coming up, like you have IoT, you have 3D printing, you have cybersecurity, you have big data analytics, right? you have quantum computing. So if any such type of emerging technologies related lab is established, and then you are taking up some industry oriented problems, projects you are giving to the students. So if you can demonstrate that, yeah, that is going to be excellent in front of the experts, right? Quality of completed projects or working prototypes, very, very important. How we are going to judge the quality of those projects? That's what I'm telling, right? If you give the repeated projects and some of the students are very smart, so, right, they don't do anything, and then they'll simply come up with that photocopied version and then they will try to submit it. And then evidence of papers published, very, very important, very, very important, right? I have seen in several institutions that a BTech student is publishing in an international journal. I don't have any objection. If the quality of that paper is very good and it is being published in a reasonably good journal of at least Scopus level or better than that, or even UGC listed journal, current UGC listed journals, so, or maybe above that, I don't have any objection, right? But most of these journals, right, when we interact with the faculty, they're all morning, evening type, right? Maine iska naam de diya tha, subah sham wala journals, subah sham, right? Subah paper bhej diya, morning you have submitted the paper, right? By evening, you got the confirmation that your paper is accepted and pay these 3,000 rupees or 8,000 rupees or 15,000 rupees, and this paper will be published in next 3 days, right? Today, I have submitted by, today is Friday, by Monday, my paper is published, right? Only thing, your paper is published only when you pay these 15,000 rupees. No comments are there. Even the some of the journals are very smart, right? They have a standard format of comments also, right? The comments are also only you have to tick mark that box on, right? Left side, you have one parameter, and right side, you have five options. You have to only tick mark it. That's all. So those are the comments. So what my suggestion is, instead of encouraging your students to publish in this type of below average journals, not quality journals, why don't you encourage your students to publish in a good international conference, good national conference being organized by some of the good institutions, right? Which are the student get an opportunity to go there and even present it, right? Even in this pandemic time, many conferences are being held online. So at least they will face the audience. They will try to present it, what work they have done, what novelty they have brought in, and then they are ready to face some questions, right, from the audience also. So by doing this, students will learn many things, right? How to face the audience, how to present their work, how to present their idea, how to present their novelty, right? How to respond to the question that is raised by the experts, right? Even they cannot respond it, at least that may be a good question that they never thought about it in their work. So that gives an idea that how they can improve their work further, right? Very, very important. So my takeaway here is, I wanted to tell you is, do not encourage your students for these subah sham wala journals, morning, evening journals, right? Try to let it be, right? Suppose you have 120 students in your final year batch. All students may not be able to publish papers. Some students are good in doing some sort of prototype. Good, right? Maybe that prototype cannot be published, let us say, right? Because it is the same thing that they have implemented from an application. No problem, right? They can have a demonstration type of prototype which they can show to the experts when they come, right? Some students have done a very good work, right? That you decide as a teacher, whether it can go in a conference, whether it is going in a Scopus journal, whether it can go in a UGC list, current list of journals, or maybe even a CA also, right? I have seen in one or two institutions like NITs also I visited, right? There are some students who have published in SCA journal also, right? Even BTech student, amazing, right? But that is very few in number, very few, because they have limited time. Right. And then students are also not having that type of vast knowledge like MTech and PhD students. Right. So definitely they can go for Scopus or UGC list, UGC care list journals and so on and so forth. Very important. And this same quality is applicable for faculty publications also. Right. When we come to the criteria number 5. Right. So don't you set a benchmark for your department. Right. So no faculty should publish in this type of journal. That is the order that is circulated to all the faculty, and all the students have been conveyed by the faculty. So there is a benchmark. So you can tell the experts, sir, we are only publishing. We have a limited publication, doesn't matter, but we are quality oriented. So experts will be very happy to see, because you are improving over a period of time, right? With respect to the quality. Quality is in your mind. Quality is in your attitude, right? That should be demonstrated. Okay. If you can see here, quality of place, host, where the paper has been published. Very, very important. That's what I was telling you, right? Okay. And based on projects demonstration, suppose some students could not publish a paper, they have done a good work, they are able to demonstrate their prototype. Excellent, nothing like it, right? So students should be prepared how to demonstrate their prototype, what new things they have implemented, what things they have learned out of this. If they can connect this prototype or paper publication with respect to your POs and PSOs or COs attainment, That is excellent. That means students are also aware of what are these COs. Students are also aware of what are these POs. Students are also aware of what are these PSOs. Students are also aware of why this outcome-based education all of a sudden. So they are also in line with the teachers. They are also in line with the entire management of the institute. Very important. Initiatives related to industry interaction. Very important. Right? Industry-supported laboratories, as I was telling you, right? Here I wanted to give one of the experience that I faced in one institution. Right, they had one lab on computer science only, because I visited only computer science or IT departments only. So they had one HPC lab, high performance computing lab. They also had one Internet of Things laboratory. Right, so that is a 3 or 4 story building. So we were in the ground floor. They told that, sir, we have two industry supported labs. Right, this HPC was sponsored or maybe in collaboration with Intel. IoT was with some other industry, right? So we were in the ground floor, and this lab was in second or third floor. So we were taken to the lift, and then we went there. And then surprisingly, when we went there to the third floor, we found that both the labs are locked, right? Visit is going on, expert visit is going on, right? Okay, and then when we went to the third floor, it is on their request only we went, right? It is not, we were not knowing what lab they have, right? It is their responsibility to show. So they took us to the third floor, and then we found that both the labs are locked. High performance computing laboratory is also locked, which is in collaboration with Intel. Then other one also is locked, which is IoT. Then they have found a key, and then they opened it. Then we understood, when the lab is locked, no students are there, then what is happening? We understood. So still, right, we went inside. So if they have done a good work in the HPC lab by the students along with the faculty, there should be some display. Maybe some publication was there, some prototype was developed, some display should be there. No students are there, no faculty is there to explain what is happening in this lab. Similarly, in IoT lab, some faculty were there, no students were there, they were trying to tell. So don't just for namesake that you establish labs, but see that these labs are utilized effectively by the students, by the faculty, so that concrete outcome is coming up, which can be correlated with the program attainment, which can be correlated with the program specific attainment, which is really helping for the students from the placement point of view, right? Because these are all emerging technology, HPC and IoT and all those things. So that your students, right, they'll be able to face better interviews when the campus placement is happening, right? Okay, all this industry involvement is very, very important, right? With respect to program design and curriculum, right? Even the industry experts are partially delivering or fully delivering in one or two some of the courses. Like I've seen, there are some places where the TCS, right, is handling one subject, right? I have seen some of the places where the Infosys, they're not directly dealing with the student, but they're training the faculty. In turn, the faculty will train their students. Like there's something called Campus Connect, TCS is doing it. There are some other companies are also doing this type of jobs. So you can always, right, go for this type of this thing, right? Whether partial delivery or full delivery, one or two programs, right, delivered by the industry experts, and then take the feedback of the students, whether are they liking it, what type of benefit they are getting it out of these sessions being delivered by the industry experts, right? Then initiatives related to industry internship and summer training, right? Some of the institutions is very good internship, right? All students compulsorily they have to go for the industry internship, right? But some of the places it is optional, right? Students are left to themselves, right? So if my parents or some relatives are in a high position, so I am very fortunate that I can get an internship somewhere, summer training or internship. But other students, right? Those from rural background, those who are parents are not that influential. So they are not able to see this industry internship option, right? So my suggestion would be, as a institute, as a department, you should have a policy that, right? Maybe if your university is not compelling the compulsory internship, then maybe you should fight it out in the board of studies meeting that this internship, at least summer training, 2 weeks or 3 weeks or 4 weeks should be made compulsory to the students at least once in their lifetime of 4 years, right, in the institute. So that you need to take care. But from the university point of view, tier one institutions, yes, you have all the freedom to come up with your curriculum, right, where the industry internship can be made compulsory. So industry internship, you want to make it very strong and effective. Your career guidance and training and placement shell should be very strong. That means they have a good interface, strong interface with the industry, so that they are able to help the departments and the students for this industry internship and summer training from across the industries in that place, right? Okay. So this is criteria number two, very, very important. And criteria number three is course outcomes and program outcomes. So here I wanted to say, because already it is covered, how to write course outcomes properly, and then how to map them with program outcomes and PSOs. I've also seen that some sessions have been held how to measure the attainments of all these COs, POs, and PSOs, right? Only thing is, first step is you should learn how to make your define your COs, which are measurable, right? Which are measurable. That means every CO should have a action work, right? So less number of zeros or no COs should have this understanding and remembering level, right? So you can have it to implement, to design, to evaluate, right? Something like that, which can be measured when you take the internal exams, when you take the external exams, when you give some assignments, right? Practical assignments or mini projects where the students are able to develop, students are able to design something, students are able to analyze something. So this type of things you need to frame up. Once your COs are properly framed, right? POs are already given by the NBA itself these days, right? And PSOs, two or three or four, you have defined on your own with respect to the what is the objective of your particular UG or PG program, UG program specifically, right? So there is not much that I need to talk about here. Right, so you need to define COs properly and then mapping to the POs and PSO, which has been already covered, and you will be able to demonstrate this. Very important, only one thing I wanted to say is when you make a departmental presentation before the experts, see that you have made some samples. Let us say for two subjects, you have demonstrated how you have calculated attainments of the COs, right? And then you have also demonstrated how the POs are calculated, right? Attainment of POs calculation is done. Maybe one or two POs you can demonstrate, right? And then PSO similarly. That is very, very. So you should be able to justify why you have done, how you have done, and how you are able to see that whether you are achieving this target that you have kept or not. That's what is the whole crux of this outcome-based education, right? So very, very important criteria. So you need to catch this properly because it is having good number of marks, 175 marks out of 1,000. Right, almost 18%, right? 18% marks are available for this, right? 200 marks roughly, right? 200 marks for one this thing. So very important. Okay, then students performance is all data driven, right? So enrollment ratio, if you are more than 90% of the seats are filled in that particular program, you will get full marks, right? Okay, so if it is less than 60% enrollment ratio, that admission is happening, then you will get zero marks, right? Even I am sure that in the pre-qualifiers earlier, right, and currently I think they have removed that, but earlier pre-qualifiers were very rigid. So if your admissions are less than 60% at the department level or the institute level, then you are even not permitted to go for the SAR submission also, right? So that means an institution where the 40% or more than 40% of the seats are vacant, right, then you can imagine from here itself what is the status of the institution, what is the health of the institution or the department, right? You can always guess from here itself. So one is success rate in the stipulated period of the program, that is with backlogs and without backlogs, right? How many of your students, like 120 students have taken admission in the first year, out of this 120, how many of the students without any backlog in any semester, any year of study has passed in one go, right? If that number is very high, right, let us say 100 students are there, 90% of the students, right, in your department program have passed without any backlog in any semester, in year of study. That means your program is running successfully very well, right? Successfully very well, right? If that number is coming down, like maybe to 60% students are passing out in one go, and the rest 40% or maybe, and that 40% also maybe 30% or 25% are going, rest 50%, they are not able to complete even in 5 years, 4 years also. So that need to be seen. Okay, then you have this academic performance in the second year also, right? So that means earlier, right, when you see this before 2016, if I remember correctly, right, they were not asking this second year performance separately, first year performance separately, because why this first year criteria separately introduced in criteria number 8 is because there were many students actually were not able to clear the subjects in the first year. They were really struggling, right? So based on the feedback that you have received from the faculty and the institutions, we found that students actually from the spoon feeding system of plus one and plus two, they are entering into an engineering college or a diploma level institution, right? And then all of a sudden in this college ATMA, they don't have this spoon feeding system. So they are not able to cope up with the college atmosphere, right? So that is the reason the first year criteria is kept separately. And then they introduced the second year performance and then final year performance also. So one of the most important, this is 4.4, very, very important. This outcome based, right? I tell always, right, this is my gut feeling that outcome of the student is measured. One is 100 students have taken admission, all the 100 have passed out in 4 years, with backlogs or without backlogs, right? So that means you have taken 100, 100 have been produced. So after producing the student successfully with a degree, now the important outcome is how many of them are placed out of this 100, right? If they are placed, how many are core company placements? Suppose a BTech computer science engineering students, how many of them are placed in a core company? If it is a BTech mechanical engineering student, how many of these mechanical engineering students out of 100 are placed in the core mechanical engineering companies, right? So if they are placed, it's very good. After placement, your next target should be how many of them are going to the concerned discipline placements. Very, very important, right? And then you need to have the documentary evidence. You say that let us out of 100 students, 85 students are placed. So you should have at least 85 proper offer letters, right? I again emphasize here, 85 at least proper offer letter. That means student name is mentioned, his package is mentioned, right? All the terms and conditions are mentioned, and there is a signature also, right? So proper. So I have seen some of the institutions like they are showing an email, right? From let us say TCS. So TCS has mentioned name of the 50 students only. That's all, right? These are the students that have been selected. So no offer letter is there, no details are there, nothing is there, right? So how to consider this? How to consider this, right? So now the question comes is when we ask the faculty in the department for the offer letters, sometimes they say that these are available in the placement office. And a placement office is within your institute only, right? So you can always get a copy of it and keep it with you also in your record, right? Photocopy of it. So sometimes this is also not happening. That placement cell says and the department says that sir, actually these offer letters are directly issued to the students. The students are not giving to you. Now I will tell you one more thing. When your departmental presentation was going on, when the institute presentation by your director or principal or vice chancellor is going on, they say that your alumni connect is very strong. Your alumni connect is very strong, right? They boasted of their alumni connect. But when it's coming to the placements, they are saying in the department, in the placement cells are offer letters are directly going to the student and they are not sharing with you. Now you can imagine how strong is your alumni connect, right? Because you are also a teacher, I am also a teacher, expert is also a teacher only, right? What you have said in your presentations and what is actually visible is you are not having the data, your students are not willing to share the offer letter also with you, or you are not able to reach to your students also. So what type of strong connect you have that the experts also will be able to judge from this? Very important, right? Then higher studies also, right? How many of your students are going for ME admission, MTech admission, or MS in other countries, Master of Science, or even they're going for MBA admission in India or maybe in abroad, right? So that is, if it is MTech students, how many of them are going for the PhDs, right? Maybe in India or abroad, right? With fellowship or without fellowship. So you can see that how many of your students are clearing the GATE exam, GRE exam, GMAT exam, CAT exam, right? Even the UPSC exam also, right? UPSC exam also, right? They wrote an UPSC exam and they got placement in a UPSC related public sector undertaking or whatever it is. Very, very important. So you need to have a proof. For higher studies, you can have at least an identity card of the student which is valid where they are studying. Let us say one of your student is studying in NIT Warangal or NIT Tiruchirappalli or NIT Jalandhar, NIT, right? Kurukshetra. So you can have an identity card of the student, right? If you don't have identity card, at least a GATE score card that they have a reasonably good score, right? They're qualified in the GATE exam, right? So if you have identity card, nothing like it, at least a GATE score card, right? Out of 100 students, 10 students have cleared the GATE exam, right? 5 students have cleared the CAT exam, right? And then identity card is also supported by that, excellent, nothing like it. So without proof, what I mean to say, without documentary evidence, this data is not going to be considered. This data is not going to be considered. And with respect to the entrepreneurship, right? You need to have some evidences. Like suppose say two students of your particular discipline, right? They have started a startup company. So they might have registered, right? So there should be a registration document, right? Registration document should be available. They might be having, these days everybody is having a website, right? So there should be a website also, right? So that is very, 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 very important, right? So you need to see that all the documentary evidences, whatever data that you are claiming under this you have the documentary evidences. If you don't have documentary evidences, then accordingly this number will come down, right? Out of 30, maybe earlier you have counted 30 out of 30, right? You have produced entrepreneurs also, your students are gone for higher studies also, you have claimed that, right, 100% placement is also happening, right? And then you claim 30 out of 30. And then after verification, I have seen many institutions, this 30 number became 10 also, right? Because they didn't have the placement offer letters. They didn't have proper proof for higher studies. They didn't have proper documents or maybe any evidences for the entrepreneurs also that they have produced. So please make that note of it. Then professional activity, just I wanted to tell you that you need to have, right? They have some professionals, like you have a CSA chapter, you have IEEE chapter, you have ASME chapter, right? Similarly, for other engineering branches, you may be having some well-known chapters. Chapters are available in some places, but the number of events and the quality of the events that they have organized and the effect of those events on the students, right? Skills or competencies or knowledge upgradation, right? That is not visible, right? You hold an event, but then some of the students did not maintain even the attendance also. How many students have attended this program? Right? Even if they have attended, there is no, what is the outcome of this event? After the holding this event, what is the benefit the students have got? What is the benefit students have got it, right? So that is not visible, right? So why don't you ask for, like one example I can give you after the event that you have conducted, you ask your students to submit a write-up, small write-up, right? What did they learn out of this event, right? What technical things they have gained, which they were not knowing earlier, now they know it, right? So some small report can be always asked, one page report or a half page report from each of the students. And then some teachers can see it and then make a note of it, like, okay, these are the things that they have gained out of these events. That means everything is focused. That means you have kept something, an outcome in your mind, and you are holding these events, right? It's not that conducting purpose, I am conducting a national conference. Just for conducting, I am conducting international conference. Just for conducting purpose, I am conducting one webinar, right? Just to number pura karne ke liye. That should not be the objective, but there is a focus, right? What is the outcome of all these events? Then publication of technical magazines, newsletters, etc. Right? Sometimes they have these magazines at the institute level. Sometimes they have at this department level also some newsletters. But then you need to show that who are the students from your department, they are contributing at the institute level, at the department level. That means on the editorial board at the end of the newsletter, the magazine, your students also should be appearing, preferably with their name and roll number also, right? From the roll number also, we can identify from which branch these students are there. Then only you can claim it, whether it is at the institute level or the department level. Okay, very, very important. That's what you can see here. Students' participation is very, very important because this is a student section. Criterion number 4 is everything is students' outcome. Okay, then this participating inter-institute events by students of the program at other institutions also, right? Some are within your institution, within your state, outside the states. What are the prizes? What are the awards students have got it? All the documentary evidences you should have, right? So you should encourage your students go beyond your state also. You should encourage your students, the students should go beyond your city. Like for example, you're located in Hyderabad. So your students are participating only events of the Hyderabad. They are not going to anywhere in Telangana or Andhra, right? Okay, so that is also very, very important. Very, very important, right? So take care of all these things. Then this important criteria, right? So if I complete very important criteria, why this is very important? Because you are all faculty. So this criteria is purely related to you only, right? Faculty information and contributions, okay? And this is the criteria which is having the highest marks, highest weightage, right? Out of 1,000 marks, 20% weightage is given to this. 20% weightage is given to this. And the next criteria which is having the highest score is your COs and POs. The criteria number 3, 175 marks, right? So very important criteria. You should not neglect this criteria and you should focus on this. And you will also see in the accreditation criteria document, 3 years or 6 years, right? And it is written that criteria number 5 should not have not less than 60% marks, right? 60% or 40%, right? I don't remember the number, but it is written very clearly that you should have that minimum score in this particular criteria. Suppose you got, let us say, 620 marks, but you are not able to fulfill this threshold of criteria number 5. Still, you will be rejected. Still, you will be rejected. Right, so you need to be very careful with this criteria number 5. In some of the diploma programs, if I remember, criteria number 4, 5, 6, right? So you should have that minimum benchmark, which is given, right? So it is not only the 600 plus marks. Along with that, there is the riders, right? Criteria number 5 should have minimum of this score. Then only you will be accredited for 3 years or maybe for 6 years also. Okay. So student faculty ratio SFR is very, very important, right? And this is slightly changed, right? Now they have made it like, for example, if you have to get the accreditation for UG program, right, in Tier 1 or Tier 2 for 6 years. Earlier it used to be your SFR should be 15 or better than that. 1:15 or better than that. Now they have slightly modified it to 1:20. 1:20, right? Whether it's a Tier 1, whether it's a Tier 2, if you are to go for 6 years accreditation, your SFR should be at least 1:20 or better than that. And that means it should be less than that, right? 1:20 or better than that. That is the meaning of it. Okay. So that small modification, they have done it in the 2020, maybe keeping in mind certain things, right? That is certain things. So that means it is really relaxed, right? Earlier it was rigid. Now it is really relaxed with respect to the SFR. So here only I wanted to say about this faculty counting, faculty counting, right? Faculty counting. So all faculty will be considered. Your regular faculty will be definitely considered, and other faculty also, right, who are on contractual faculty, right, if they have taught for 2 semesters in that particular academic year, so those faculty will be considered for the SFR calculation also, and in this criteria number 5 also. Only those faculty will not be considered who are only guest faculty, like they take the lecture and they go home, right? And they are also paid, right, per lecture wise. Suppose if I take the class today, one session, maybe I am paid 1,000 rupees. After that, I am going home, right? Okay. But I have been given the appointment as per the AICT terms and conditions, right? I am being paid maybe a consolidated salary, right? But my appointment is for 1 year, that full academic session, I have taught both the semester, then you will be counted. Okay. But if I have not taught in both the semester, let us say I have in the academic year, let us say 2021 or 2021-22, 2021, which is already over, right? So let us say it starts from July and it goes up to June 2021. So if I have not taught in both the semesters on that particular academic year, then I will not be counted in that particular year, right? Maybe before that, 1920, I have been involved both the semesters. 1920, I will be counted, but 2021, I may not be counted because you are a contractual faculty, right?
Hello, excuse me, sir.
Yes, sir.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, are the adjunct faculty can be counted?
Yes. If they have taught for 2 consecutive semesters in that academic year.
Okay. Except guest faculty, we can show other.
Yeah, only that lecture-wise payment karte, right? Unko chhodke.
Okay, sir.
That's all will be considered. If you have a documentary evidence that they have taught for 2 semesters and you are following these guidelines, right? AICT qualification they are fulfilling, yeah. Right? All those things.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So faculty cadre proportion, that is you need to maintain as per AICT 1:2:6. So even if you are not able to maintain it, then you lose some marks, right? You lose some marks. Out of 20, you may lose some marks. So you don't have 1:2:2, that means 1 professor, 2 associate professors and 6 assistant professors. So you lose some marks. But there is some compulsion also that every department should have 2 professors or 1 professor and 1 associate professor at least, right? With PhD, all those conditions are there that you need to be fulfilled. Then faculty qualification, right? Very important criteria. How many of your faculty are with PhD, right? X is number of faculty with PhD. More is the number of faculty with PhD, right? Better will be this score, right? And no faculty should have the designation of lecturer, and no faculty should have BTEC only, right? That means minimum qualification is MTech, right? And the faculty should have been given the designation of assistant professor, not lecturer. If he is MTech, he is recruited in a BTEC program department and he is given the designation lecturer, he will not be counted. Though you may be having MTech, but designation lecturer, he will not be counted for the faculty, right? This happened with some technical university in southern India, right? So they have recruited the faculty, they have MTech degree, right? But they were given the designation of lecturer. So those faculty were not counted for the SFR purpose. Because the NBA is very clear on that. No faculty should be given the designation of lecturer with MTech. Okay. and no faculty should be recruited with BTech and you are given the assistant professor designation. That is also of no use. They will also not count it. So take care of that. But that's all. So more is the number of faculty with PhD and better is this score that you will get as per this formula. And faculty retention, very important, right? In government institutions, right, there is not a problem of faculty retention. It is like a marriage, right? Once you are married, no divorce. Okay, no divorce. So no problem at all in government. Once they come here, nobody is going to leave, right? Nobody is going to leave unless until they get a better opportunity somewhere else, they will not leave. But in the private institutions, right, it's very, very important is faculty retention, right? So faculty retention is, let us say, right, in 2000, let us say your assessment years are 2021 and then 1920 and then let us say 1819. So 1819 will list the faculty, right? 1819 will list the faculty, right? And then see how many of them are retained in 2021. Or maybe let us say 1920 faculty list out, how many are retained in 21 and 22, right? That means let us say there are 10 faculty with the name A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, right? So in 21-22, A is retained or not, B is retained or not, right? That like that you have to count. So there are 10 faculty in 1920, A, B, C, D up to 10, right? And then 21-22, let us say A, B, C, D have gone, right? Out of 10, A, B, C, D have gone, only the rest of the them. That means your retention is only 60%, right? So accordingly, you will get these marks, right? 60%, accordingly, you will get these marks. Okay, that's how you have to calculate your retention. So the more, suppose 100% is retained, so then you will get 10 marks. Not only that, it shows that your institution policies are very good. Every faculty is liking it. They're very comfortable, very happy about the work culture and administration and everything. So therefore, they are not willing to leave it. Their salaries are good, their perks are good, their incentives are good, work culture is good. So nobody wants to leave it. Nobody wants to leave it. So that talks other things also. It's not only getting these marks, but it will also talk about that the employees are very satisfied, very satisfied. Okay, faculty competencies, nothing to explain it over here. So you should have all the faculty to care of the entire curriculum that you have defined for your programs, right? And then the research publications, right? Every faculty can have a profile that you can show it, like in which area they are specialized and what type of research work they are doing it and which type of courses they are taking, so that every course in the curriculum that is defined second, third and final year is taken care. Then innovations by the faculty in teaching learning, very important. Right. So if you are doing anything innovative in your teaching learning process, that should be made available. Right. Not only you are doing it, that should be made available on your institute website. Right. That should be made available for the peer review and critic. And that should also be made available reproducibility and reusability by other scholars. Okay. That means it's some sort of open source. Right. I have done something good. I developed a system as a department, as an institution. I not only my institute is being innovative, my department is being innovative, I have put it for the other people also, other technical institutions also, they can also use this and they can promote it, right? If it is good, very, very important. So you need to have all those things in place, and then you need to have some statistics for that. Like how many people are, suppose you have come up with a beautiful, wonderful lecture videos, right? Lecture videos is a very tough subject, nowhere it is available. Even if it is available, the way that you have explained it is not available. So you made it available to all the students. Right? Students or faculty from other institutions. So you should have a statistics like how many of them have downloaded, which institution, right? How many students, how many faculty in India, in abroad, in your state, within your state, outside your state, all those details you can capture it from the website and you can present to the experts. Then 5.7 is very, very important. Faculty has participated in faculty development training activities and short-term training programs. Right? In many private institutions, especially I face the problem that they have attended many programs, but most of the programs or all of the programs are only in-house, right? There is nothing wrong in conducting internal programs, right? In-house programs, there is nothing wrong in that. But the question of this faculty being deputed or sponsored for attending programs outside the institute, there is a reason for it, right? So when they go outside, they gain many things. One is they are away from the institute, right? So they are fully focused on the program that they are going for, right? Even many a times they may not be knowing how to plan for their journey, right? Because they never traveled outside. Okay. So they learn how to plan for attending that program. Once they go to that institute, they see many new things also, right? Many new things also. Maybe their lab was excellent. Suppose say I am a private institution located in a rural environment, but I have been sponsored to attend a program in one of the best IIT, right? So first of all, I got an opportunity to see one of the best institute in the country, right? I have been taught by one of the best faculty in the entire India, right? I am exposed to one of the best lab, which I never saw it, right? An Internet of Things or maybe an artificial intelligence, which I am made to see, and I am fortunate to listen to the best of the experts. And then I am trying to learn. There are so many tools are available, which even name is not known to me earlier, right? So some of the best things that they will see in those institutions will come back and try to incorporate in their teaching learning process. And then they will try to develop those labs or those facilities in the classroom, in the lab, in their own department where they are serving. That is the purpose of this 5.7, right? So there is nothing wrong in in-house programs, but the purpose is defeated. If all programs are only in-house, the purpose is defeated. Right? So please take care of that. I have seen few institutions or majority of the private institutions, maximum programs are only in-house, right? Maximum program. So in-house, there is a problem also, right? When I'm attending a class, right, then some call will come, some principal will call, some HOD will call, somebody else will call, right? So then I am defocused. Once I am away from the institute, because institute also knows, department also knows, I am not in Chandigarh. So automatically my communication with the institute will be minimized so that I am not disturbed unless until it is an emergency. Okay, so academic research, very important. That's what I was telling you. Number of quality publications in refereed or SCI journals. If you can also keep these citations, like maybe Google Scholar citations, ResearchGate score, you can maintain it, right? Even Scopus index citations also you can maintain it. Or you have a Web of Science page also. So that means every faculty should be requested to make this faculty profile page, right? So see that you highlight only the quality publications, right? We all know what are quality publications, right? So highlight those things only. Right? Maybe let us say you have in a particular year, you are 50 faculty. Let us say you have only 10 quality publications. Nothing wrong. Nothing wrong, right? So apart from these 10, let us say you have another 20 also, which are not that quality as listed here. So you can say that, sir, 10 are SCI publications, right? SCIE, right? Okay. Some are transaction. One paper is transaction paper, right? And then some are Scopus also in this. So we have considered the quality only Scopus, right? Maybe preferably non-paid journals, right? And then SCIE also non-paid journals, right? With some impact factors also. 10 are these publications. Another 20 also we have, sir, but they are not quality because we ourselves have kept it aside. Now, we are following you from these areas onwards. We don't want this 20 also, right? We are telling our faculty, instead of 20, you publish only one in 1 year. We'll be more than happy, more than happy. And then some incentives also institute has kept it. If you publish a paper in SCI, you will be rewarded 5,000 rupees. Right, so then automatically the faculty will be attracted to publish in good journals, quality journals, refereed journals, right, and all those things. And then PhD is awarded during the assessment period while you are working in this institute as a faculty. Let us say I am working in NIEEE or now I have produced, let us say, 9 PhDs, right? Okay, so next year I have joined, let us say in 21-22 I have joined in some other institute. So these 9 will not be counted in that institute where I am going, right? So during my stay, during the assessment year of 3 years, how many PhDs have been produced when I'm working there? That is going to be counted. Very, very important. Then very important is a very weak area in most of the institutions is sponsored research, including government institutions, including government. I have gone to some of the NITs also. They are also not very good in this sponsored research the way it could have been, right? But you understand here, I have highlighted the word cumulative, right? Over the 3 years, three assessment years, it is not that one faculty have to get this 50 lakh rupees, right? It is not that one faculty have to get it each year, no, right? It is the cumulative of all the faculty research, sponsored research project over a period of 3 years, okay? Suppose you have 20 faculty, right? All 20 faculty put together in a period of 3 years, let us say you got 50 lakh funding. Not a big amount, right? Not a big amount, right? Not an impossible amount, right? Okay, so if you got it 50 lakhs, you will get 20 marks, right? 20 marks, very, very important, very, very important. So you can target for small, small projects instead of going for a 1 crore project or 10 crore project where the likelihood of rejection is very high. So you go for small projects like 2 lakhs, 3 lakhs, right? Level, there are 20 faculties there. Every faculty, let us say out of them, 50% of the faculty is experts in getting this, writing these project proposals and sponsored research, right? So 10 faculty, let us say average, every faculty applies for 3 lakh funding, right? So if, let us say, hypothetically out of 10, 8 will get it. So 8 into 3 is 24 lakhs, right? So instead of getting 0 marks, you will get at least this 5 marks, right? At least this. So that means at least you have made a start, right? Out of 20 faculty, 10 faculty applied for the proposals and 8 of them have got it. That is a good success rate. Though the marks are less, but you are on the progressive path. You are on the progressive path. That's what is very good. So don't go for very big projects, especially if you are a private institution. If you don't have very strong background of how to write good research proposals and all those things, target small, small ones, right? Sometimes your state governments also, like Department of Science and Technology within the state, also gives this small, small funding of 50,000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees, 1.5 lakh rupees. So target those things also, right? And you can go for it, right? Very, very important. And I have seen that most of the institutions, right? The 50 plus institutions I have visited, I should say that 40 plus institutions have got 0 marks, right? Here, 0 marks, right? 0 marks, 0 marks. Recently, right, in December 2020, one institute, right, in online mode, I in this sponsored research, they have claimed 60 lakhs, right? When the visit happened, they could not produce sufficient evidence of this, getting this funding. And the 60 lakhs became only 3 lakhs. Still 0 marks, right? Because less than 15 lakhs is going to be 0 marks. Okay. So they have shown that all project proposals they have applied for, they have not received the funding. So they have shown in the SAR, so what all they have applied for, it is around 60 lakhs. But finally, when we verified, it's only 3 lakhs, which they had the letter, offer letter, and the money has been transferred to the institute. So 0 marks, right? So it's a very, very important one. And 20 marks is a good number out of 200, right? You should be focusing on that. Then developmental activities like product development, you have made some prototypes. If prototype is developed, have you gone for a patenting or have you transferred the technology for the production? Right, those type of things you can show it. Not you are just projects of the students and after that you have not done anything, right? A prototype which is worth of going for patenting, a prototype which is worth of transferring the technology, right? Or a prototype which is actually installed in your institute and it is being successfully utilized by the people, right? You have not earned anything, but it is being used. It is helping people, it is assisting people, right? Technology is basically used it in your campus itself, or maybe somebody else is using it, okay? So all those things are very, very important. Then another very important weak area that I have seen is consultancy from the industry. Again, the same thing I have seen, that most of the institutions have got 0 score. And here also it is cumulative across the faculty, across the 3 assessment years. It is not the individual faculty is getting these 10 lakhs. 10 lakhs is not a big amount, right? Big amount. And that too over a period of 3 assessment years across all the faculty put together, right? Again, the concept is go for small, small ones. Don't target this directly 10 lakh projects. Right? Small 50,000 rupees, 25,000 rupees, but you have a good number of faculty put together. So you should be able to reach this number of 10 lakhs. Again, this December 2020 institute, I'll tell, they have listed for 100 crore consultancy from the industry. 100 crore. So after verification, we found that this 100 crore became only 4 lakhs. 4 lakhs, right? All those things they have listed, that which they are going to, they have applied it or they are going to get it in future, right? Something like that, and all they have. There is no documentary evidence is available, right? So they all have been cut down and then the number has been reduced. 4 lakhs means not bad. Instead of 0 marks, at least they got 2 marks, right? But they have misunderstood that, right? 100 crores. 100 crores is not a small amount, right? But then when you're writing that, you should be very careful because experts are also faculty like you. So they carry a bad impression, right? They don't know what to show also under this section. That type of impression will come, right? Okay. Then faculty performance appraisal and development system. So most of the institutes I have seen that there is a well-defined performance appraisal system is available, but its implementation and effectiveness is not visible when it is being done, right? When it is being done. So this first part is fine, but the second part is the weak part in most of the institutions, okay? Especially the private institutions. Visiting adjunct and emeritus faculty, if they are available, then right, then you will get 1 mark. There is a provision like means at least you have a policy to have this visiting faculty, adjunct faculty, emeritus faculty. And if you have already 1 or 2 in place, you will get 1 mark, right? And then next is 9 marks are for the engagement, interaction. If they have completed minimum of 50 hours per year interaction, then only you will get 3 marks in that particular year. So all 3 years they have been engaged for at least 50 hours, right? Each year, then you will get full marks. So 200 marks are going to be like this. Right? I'm almost done, right? I'll leave you on time. Okay. So criteria number 6 is self-explanatory. Facilities and technical support. And again, I will emphasize here, most of the institutions have got at least 60 marks, right? 60 and above. So because your institute is running, your department program is very old, right? Everything is in place. Labs are there. Classrooms are there. Classrooms are equipped properly. Labs are equipped properly, right? You have technical staff, right? You have safety measures in place, your project laboratory. So you will get even 70, 75 marks also. I've seen institute getting 72 also, 75 also, right? The wonderful infrastructure, they have developed it. Okay. So you should at least score here, right? But many of the institutions where I have seen marks losing is the faculty criteria number 5. I have seen in then criteria number 3, the COPO also a lot of marks. Sometimes they will lose even 50-60% marks, even more than that also they are losing in criteria number 3, which is the crux of the outcome-based education, right? Crux of the outcome-based, right? And they are also losing marks in criteria number 4, especially the performance in the final years, right? That is stipulated period with backlogs, without backlogs. Right, even the placements, higher studies, entrepreneurship also, and majority of the institution, because their placements are only 60%. Forget about higher studies, forget about entrepreneurs, right? So naturally you are losing marks over there. Okay, so here in this criteria number 6, technical manpower, right? I have highlighted only technical manpower. The rest are self-explanatory, and most of them, they have it. Availability of adequate and qualified technical supporting staff, very important, right? So they should be available, and they should also be upgrading their knowledge, right? What are the strategies that you have made? Let's like for faculty, you are sending them for the faculty development programs. Similarly, your technical staff also should be encouraged to go for Cisco-based courses, Oracle-based courses, or right, VMware certifications, this type of, which is really helpful for them to handle the labs. So that is also very, very important. Safety measures in laboratories, very important, right? In a department like CSC or IT, you may not be having much of safety measures, except like we can have one first aid box, right? Because we are not doing anything like, which is very, very dangerous in this CSC and IT field. But departments like mechanical engineering, department like civil engineering, department like electrical engineering, I'll tell you one example in our own institute, when we went for the accreditation of our electrical PG program, right? So the expert came from IIT Kharagpur. Okay, so they were showing the machines lab, electrical machines lab, and there are certain norms, right, electrical machines lab, right? So one of the girl student, right, she has not tied up her hair, right? She was supposed to tie up the hair, but she has left it open, right? So that is a safety risk. The expert has pointed out that this student, right, is very risky, right? Baal ko bandha nahi, right? Hair is not tied up, right? Suppose if it happens, like if the hair got stuck up in the machine somewhere while doing something, it's going to be very dangerous. And then other thing is, in the electrical machines lab, it appears that they are supposed to wear the shoes. So she has not tied up the hair. She doesn't have the shoe also, right? And you are not supposed to wear the loose clothes, right? Okay, but she was wearing the tight clothes. So all these type of things are also pointed out. Don't think that only first aid box is the only safety measure, right? And then your electrical equipment, they should have proper earthing, should be there at the institute level, right? So proper earthing is required. Proper safety measures are required. Even if it is your chemistry lab, right? How are you disposing hazardous chemicals? Right? How are you disposing them? That is also very important. Very important, right? So all these things, if you are there, then there is no reason that you will get less marks out of 10. And even this firefighting system, right? Firefighting is like this ABC, right? In every floor, this ABC cylinder is kept there, but nobody knows how to operate. The expert asks that, can you demonstrate how you are going to use this? Right? So nobody is knowing how to operate it. So you should train your people. And every floor, students also, faculty also, technical staff also, attendants also, right? In case of any emergency, in case of any fire, they should be able to operate it. And also this, right? There should be a check, right? There should be a check on these cylinders and aqua guard if it is installed for water purpose, safety water drinking, right? So that they are regularly inspected, and then they are kept in working condition, and they are delivering what they are supposed to deliver it. Very, very important. Then project lab, right? So if you have a separate lab, it's excellent, right? Nothing like it. And then what are the facilities available? How the students are utilizing it? So there is a record of which students have really used it, what they have developed and all those things, right? So take care of that. And I am sure that you will get more than 60 marks very easily in this particular criteria. And again, I emphasize, every mark in accreditation is very, very important for 3 years or 6 years, right? Very, very important. Continuous improvement, this criteria is again linked to the criteria number 3. That means whatever you have achieved in PO attainment and PSO attainment, here you are going to analyze it, right? Analyze it with respect to the PO attainment, PSO attainment, what are the gaps, why you could not attain a particular PO, the target was something to, let us say 2.5, but you got is 2.0, and why is it so, what are the subjects responsible, right? What are the labs that are responsible? So you need to identify those gaps and then implement the action plan. Similarly, PSOs also. Then academic audit and actions taken, right? Do you have any external academic audit, right? Some of the institutes I have seen that they have an academic audit internal. That means CSE department academic audit done is by the electronics department academic audit done by the CSE department, right? But then you have any external audit, like you have invited somebody from a reputed institution, right? Academic or industry experts also, and then you have taken the this academic audit, and then what are the concerns, what are the weaknesses, what are the deficiencies there that they have found, how you have worked on that for the continuous improvement purpose. Similarly, is there any improvement in the placements, higher studies and entrepreneurship with respect to quality, with respect to quantity, with respect to salary package, right? All those things are very, with respect to students, right? Earlier, my students were going from private institution, one private institute to other private institution, right? Next year, I have seen that, right? Earlier, they were going for the M.Tech, right? Some of the students have gone for even NITs now, right? Some of the government institutions, or maybe some of the students are going for IITs. That is also an improvement, right? Earlier, all students were going to private institute, better institute. But now students are getting a better GATE score, better CAT score, and they're going for the better institutions. Improvement in the quality of the students admitted to the program, right? That means your ranks, right? If you are going for the, based on the plus one, plus two marks, and then the ranking, right? Maybe it is a state level entrance exam, or it may be a JEE entrance exam, or whatever it is, whatever way mode you have taken, is there any quality of students being admitted, improvement in your particular program? Very, very important. Then first year academics, right? It is the same as what you have done it for the second, third, and final year. So it's the same things you will be doing it for CO attainment, PO attainment, PSO attainment also if possible, right? Partially or fully, whatever it is, right? You need to do it for the first year separately. That means first year faculty is applied sciences like physics department, maths department, chemistry department, right? And some of the CSE and electronics, because one or two subjects will be there from the other departments, also engineering department in first year. So all these faculty put together, right, will I'll be responsible for this first year academics. Very, very important. Okay, right? So then, all these things you will be doing it for the first year also. Then the criteria number 9 is student support systems, right? So this is at the institute level and definitely belongs to the department also. Mentoring system available in your department, right? At individual level. How are you going to take care of the mentoring of the faculty as well as mentoring of the students also. Here it is written students only, but mentoring of the faculty in the department is also very important, because there are faculty who have just joined after M.Tech. They don't have any teaching experience. So they also need mentoring from the senior faculty, like an assistant professor having maybe 10 years of experience, an associate professor in the department, senior professors available in the department, how you're going to take care of this. And feedback ke bare mein, I have already told you that feedback is definitely taken in all the institutions. The question is the frequency, question is the analysis, question is the actions taken, corrective measures taken. That has to be shown in action, and what is the impact of this feedback? Very, very important. Similarly, feedback and facilities, you need to collect. Feedback and facilities means your lab facilities, your classroom facilities, your hostel facilities, your mess facilities, right? All those things you can take it up. Then self-learning, right? Self-learning, what are the facilities? Like, the institution needs to specify the facilities, materials for learning beyond syllabus, like MOOCs, material is available, right? Not only it is available, but then how many of the students, how many of the faculty is utilizing these things, and they are doing these courses on their own, they are enough motivated, and then they are coming up with the certifications, certificates, and all those things you can keep it. Very important is career guidance and training and placement cell. Very important, right? For any educational institution, this career guidance, training, and placement cell has to be very, very strong, very, very strong. Right, because they are the ones, they are going to assist the students in terms of placements, in terms of higher studies, in terms of entrepreneurship, right? Partially entrepreneurship, but in institutions you have this 9.6 also entrepreneurship cell. But yes, career guidance also can assist the students, which students are capable to go for maybe not for the jobs, right, for the companies or for higher studies. Maybe they have a potential to go for starting the startup ventures or whatever it is, and all those things. Very important cell, very important cell, right? So this is a connect for the outside world and the institute programs, this career guidance and training and placement cell. Entrepreneurship cell also has to be very, very important, right? Many places, they have some talks, they have some department which is taking care of this, but they are not able to show any entrepreneurs have been produced, or maybe the students have been identified who can be trained to become entrepreneurs in that particular direction. Then co-curricular and extracurricular activities like NCC, NSS, sports, cultural events, right? You can have snapshots, right? Right, for all these activities, how the students are involved in annual student activities and all those things. You can have a lot of pictures, and then you can demonstrate through all those things, right? This carries 50 marks. And here also you can score a lot of marks, right? 9 also, because not a very difficult criteria, but if you do all these type of activities, you will be able to score it. This last criteria is most towards administration and the responsibility of the governance of the institute, right? But indirectly, yes, you are also responsible, like for financial resources. Financial, one is the management is having a lot of money. Good, very good. So they are keep on pumping money. But how many years they'll pump the money, right? Your students are not placed. Your students are not going for higher studies. There is no demand for admissions. So institute cannot keep on pumping the money into your institute for various activities. So financial resources, good condition, even faculty and students are also equally important, right? If the admissions are good, right? Admissions will be good only when the parents and students are able to see the placements, parents are able to see the higher studies, right? Better higher studies students are able to be trained, and then some students are going for entrepreneurship. If placements are 100%, 90% or above 90% or above 85%, then automatically you will attract the good students, right? Good students means your enrollment ratio is very high, right? Even 100% or more than 90%. If enrollment ratio is very good, that means a lot of money is flowing to your institute. So a lot of money means your health is very good. That means you can take up many activities. So in that fashion, financial resources, faculty is very, very important, right? Faculty is very, very important. Rest is all the management and the administrative setup has to have the clear policy, state the vision and mission of the institute, definitely, right? You may be one stakeholder while drafting this vision and mission statements of the institute. Definitely, right? The faculty should be involved, students should be involved, alumni should be involved when you are defining your vision and mission for your institute. And again, you should have a documentation for all those things, and it should be disseminated also properly across all the stakeholders. Right? Institute should have institutional strategic plan and effective implementation and monitoring of all those things should have. Then governing body, right? Governing body, administrative setup, functions of various bodies, service rules, procedures, recruitment and promotional policy. All things should be documented, and it is visible when we interact with the students, when we interact with the faculty, when we interact with the staff, technical and non-technical. Whatever policies, whatever things that you are claiming, they should be able to speak and they should be able to talk. So when we see the faculty retention, when we see the staff retention, automatically, right, if the retention is very high, that means everybody is very comfortable, very, 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 very comfortable, very, very comfortable, very important. Then decentralization working and grievance redressal mechanism, right? In a government institution, yes, some extent decentralized because they have HODs, their HODs have some power, right? So that is also very, very important. In private institution, I have seen that decentralization is told, but when we ask the head of the department, when we ask the faculty, right, they don't have any financial powers. They don't have any financial powers, right? Though maybe it is on the paper, the policy is written there, but they have not utilized it, or they are not, they're not able to show any documentary evidence that they have purchased anything for the purpose of the department with the financial power that has been delegated to that particular this thing. So it has to be implemented in practice, not only just as a policy, but it has to be shown in action. Delegation of financial powers, already I have touched upon. And transparency and availability of correct and ambiguous information in public domain. Very important, right? If your financial audited statements are displayed, if your mandatory disclosure, right, as per AICT and ICAI, it is displayed on your web portal, right? And then it is, this information is disseminated among your students, faculty and staff and stakeholders. So you will get 5 marks. Very important, 5 marks. Not a small number, right? Only you have to voluntarily display your information for transparency so that all the stakeholders are aware of it, and for the benefit of the public also. Then budget allocation, very, very important, right? Budget allocation, utilization and public accounting at institute level. So at the department level also, there is another one. So at the institute level, what is the process of allocating the budget for various departments? How it has been utilized, whatever is allocated, right? All those things you need to justify. You need to justify. This is written here, right? Justification of budget allocated for 3 years. Okay. Then utilization is very, very important. Balance sheet and all those things. Random verification, experts will be doing it, right? Just to check. And availability of audited statements. That's what I was telling you, right? 5 marks. right? Financial audited statements, if you display it on your website for the last few years, right? Definitely for the assessment period, then you will get five marks. Then program specific budget allocation, that's what I was saying. One is at the institute level, other one is at the department level. What is the process that you adopted for preparing the budget requirement, and then how it has been allocated by the institute, and then how as a department you have utilized it? Many a times I have seen that R&D, they have dedicated 20 lakhs. It is also allocated by the institute, but the department has not spent a single rupee out of these 20 lakhs. So that shows that it is only you are completing the formality, right? Budget estimate, allocation, but no utilization, right? So that gives a very bad picture. At the same time, we are not able to see any R&D activities also. That means money allocated, you are not utilized it. Therefore, there are no R&D activities also. There are no equipment that you have purchased which are useful for the carrying out these R&D activities also. Yeah, that is giving a bad picture, bad image for the department. Library and internet, very, very important, hey? Including e-resources and digital library, and accessibility to the students, to this library materials, in the institute, in the department, even in the hostels also, in the entire campus. If it is done, it is good. So internet, right? Internet bandwidth should be very good, depending on the number of students and faculty and staff available in the institute. And the Wi-Fi facility should be extended all over the campus, including the hostels and other areas. Internet access should be available in all the labs, classrooms, and so on and so forth. And then security, that means firewall. Right? Is there any protection for the all the services that you are providing for the users by using the internet services? Like you have a software firewall, you have a hardware firewall, right? So with these things, I have completed my all 10 criteria. So it is I have overshooted by 5 minutes, right? Because we started 5 minutes late also, right? So thanks to all the participants. If you have any specific questions, few questions, maybe in 5 or 10 minutes, if the coordinator permits me, I can take it.
Yes, sir. Please, if you have time, kindly devote some time for questions.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for very.
Yeah, the participants, either you can put it in the chat window or you can unmute yourselves and ask also.
Dear participants.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, one question is there. Sir, we identify the weak student, but in which time we take extra class for these students? Because 9 to 5 is conducting a routine classes timetable. So how we justify that we take extra classes for weak students?
Yes, sir. Very good question as a faculty, definitely. Very good question. Right. Now it is the department administration and the institute administration should plan for this. Definitely, you are employed for a particular period, right? Maybe let us say 8 hours daily. So you are already doing it 8 hours, right? So if a faculty need to be motivated, there should be some incentive, right? If you take some extra classes beyond the office hours, right, for the benefit of weak students, so your institute, your department should plan that how you are going to compensate for it, right? Maybe you are given some leave to carry out your PhD work, right? Because you took 10 classes, so you are given, let us say, 2 days extra leave, right? Extra leave to carry out your own activities. So money they are not able to give, but they have given you leave. That is an example I am telling you, right? Or maybe the institute is very kind enough. If you take one session, there you are paid, let us say, 1,000 rupees, right, for one session for the weak students. So like that, you have to go out, right? Because none of us are some babas are this thing like, okay, whole year, every semester we take classes after beyond office hours also. So my suggestion is, if any administrative heads are sitting here, so it is your responsibility to see that how they are compensated so that they are highly motivated to take these classes for the weak students, right? Improvement of the weak student. Otherwise, out of compulsion, they will definitely take it, but it's not going to be effective. It's not going to be effective because they are forced to take it. So forcing is not going to help, right? So I have only this option to offer to you. So it is your departmental issue, it is your institutional issue, administrative issue. So if they can have some incentives, and this identifying weak students and then improving them is going to be very, very effective. I have seen some institutions, right? I'll tell you one institute, I have seen two institutions rather in Tamil Nadu, right? Balwinder, you will also be very happy, and Kanika also will be very happy to listen to this. Morning breakfast and lunch is free for all faculty and staff every day.
Very nice.
Then I asked them why dinner is not free. Right, the dinner is made free, so every faculty will take weak student classes automatically. This is a fact, right? I'm not saying that management has claimed this. I interacted with faculty, I interacted with staff. Morning breakfast and lunch is free for all faculty and staff.
Very nice.
All faculty. why they will not be motivated to take these extra classes for the weak students automatically, right? Right, institute is spending so much of money, generosity, right? So they should be able to do it. So I hope I have answered your question to some extent.
Yes, sir. Sir, I have some more questions. If you permit, then I ask.
Sure, sir. I don't have any problem, sir. I am free now. Only your coordinator has to allow, because you may be having next session.
Sir, it's a play. This is a
Please ask. No problem at all.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, ours is a government polytechnic, sir. And a government polytechnic, Adilabad, Telangana state, sir. Is guest faculty is counted for SFR ratio, sir? Guest faculty.
Yeah. Again, I reiterate. I answered this question myself, right? When I was taking that faculty criteria, criteria number 5. Guest faculty engaged for 2 consecutive semesters in academic year with proper qualifications, right? An appointment letter, and they have been paid consolidated amount of salary. Let us say they paid per month 25,000 rupees as per the state government norms. And they are in institute for just like any other regular faculty. Then it is counted. Other scenario, I know it. I am coming to Rajkumar. If you are paying hourly basis, right? He has taken, let us say, 4 hours class, he paid 4,000 rupees and gone home. And next 2 days, they are not coming to institute. So they will not be counted.
That's okay.
They will not be counted.
Okay. They are paid, sir. They are paid.
I know it. If it is a consolidated and they are just like any regular faculty, they are coming to institute at 9 o'clock. You also come at 9. They also come at 9 o'clock. You leave at 5:30. They are also leaving at 5:30. You are part of the timetable. They are also part of the timetable. They are there in the institute, available to you for all academic and other activities.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Sir, diploma students not publish paper on the project work. So lack in this point and lose five marks.
Don't worry, Rajesh Chopra sahab. I have shown this form for only engineering UG level institution. If you look at the diploma levels, sir, there is no publication criteria. Don't worry, there is no publication criteria. There is no PhD producing criteria. There are
no in the project work publication is there.
Yeah, project work publication means at the technical level, implementation level, not like a UG program or PG program, right? Yours is a very minute level and very soft, right? Very soft corner for you, right? Okay. So they are not expecting that a polytechnic faculty is publishing an SEA journal paper, right? But if you have done some conference level publication, it's very good. National conference, international conference, good. Out of the project where students are doing it.
Okay.
Right? So your more focus will be, Rajesh sir, being a diploma students are very good in hands-on part. You can develop some prototypes. You can develop some prototypes and then see that it is being utilized in your institute, or maybe you are selling it as a small product, right? So that will be more appreciable for you.
Okay, sir. Sir, one more thing is that contribution to the community development related project activities.
Yes.
Here we can add CDTP schemes.
Yes, why not?
That is available.
Why not? CDTP scheme is basically meant for that only. That means your department, your institute is reaching to the community, like rural community, youth in the rural areas, right? You are developing them some hands-on type of skills, like electrician ka course, this tarika se, like computer related, like fundamentals of computer, office automation, you are teaching to them so that they are self-employed or they may be employed after attending these programs. You are already doing it. If you are part of CDTP scheme, so you can always show that. You can also do some activities through NCC and NSS also.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Any other questions? There are some questions in the chat window. Balvinder, can you read it, please?
Yes, sir. Sir, there is one question. If pre-qualifier is not accepted,
okay,
then how to apply for NB? Is there any scope if pre-qualifier is not accepted?
No scope is there. You have to first rectify your pre-qualifiers. Then you have to get through pre-qualifiers. Then only you will be allowed to go for the SCR. You have to rectify it, because they will tell you the where you are lacking, right? Where you are lacking, they will tell you. After you upload your pre-qualifiers and pay the fee, the NBA will tell you whether your pre-qualifiers are accepted or not accepted. If not accepted, why it was not accepted. Then in those areas, you have to improve it. And then again, you have to come back.
Right, sir. Right. Sir, next is can a faculty having master's qualification and having 17 to 20 years experience be eligible for assistant professor? I think this is clear-cut guideline that master's level faculty is eligible for assistant professor.
Yeah, yes, yeah. If they have an MTech degree and MA degree, I already told you that, rather I told you in other way around, right? If they're already MA and MTech, if you're given lecturer designation, they will not be counted.
Yeah.
Very strict guideline from NBA. Any faculty with MA, MTech, they're working in your institute, you are given the designation of lecturer, they will not be counted for SFR. I told you in Southern India, two universities have faced this problem, technical universities. They were working for last 10 years, but designation is lecturer, all qualifications, they are fulfilling it as per AICT. So those faculty were not counted and their programs were not given accreditation. Very pathetic condition, right? A technical university which is affiliating many private engineering colleges, right? They have got it for at least 3 years and the university could not get it.
Yes.
Very good, right? Yeah.
One more question, actually, this is from my side. We talk of course exit survey as well as feedback at the end of the course. So are these two different activities or we can merge these course exit survey with feedback? So how do you
evaluate take care of this? One is course end survey, other one is?
Feedback which we take from the student for the course. General feedback. Which we say
That's what I'm telling you. So one can be, again you use the word general feedback. General feedback, is it talking about the academic courses? Right? Academic courses that you have taught. General feedback can be library facilities, hostel facilities, right? Campus maintenance, right? Neat and clean, and the mess facilities, right? What is the quality of food being served? This is general feedback, right? But that may not be wholly taken as a academic feedback also, right? If you start saying as a course feedback you are taking, yeah. So you are talking about the academic course that you have taught, right? Yeah. So how well, how competent was the teacher? Was handling the theory portion and the practical portions, whether all the lectures were conducted on time, how effectively they are being able to deliver it, what are the various tools that they are using while they are delivering in the classroom. So this is a particular feedback about the course that a particular faculty is teaching. General feedback can be even this course also, right? In a general old department, you can also ask what are the are you satisfied with the academic activities, the way the teachers are delivering using these tools? Are you satisfied? This may be one question, but generally is many things, right? Your lab is well equipped, you have necessary tools are available, right? Classes are being held on time and lab happens on time. Lab records are checked on time, papers are shown on time, evaluation is done properly. These are all general feedback, right? Then there are hostel facility, mess facility, campus maintenance, even sports facilities. It can be at the institute level also, this entire feedback. So one is purely the academic part. Other one is other things which are not covered in this academics. So you can give a weightage. You can give a weightage for this feedback. What is the weightage for this feedback? What is the weightage?
So course exit survey should be different from this course specific feedback, or it is?
No, course means there are two meanings. One is some people will, this course is also called as a program. Program means 4 years BTech program. Are you talking about that program and survey? Are you talking about exit survey? Are you talking about the individual semester?
Course, sir, means subject end at the end of the...
Yeah, that is individual semester, right? Individual semester for all courses you have taken feedback. Individual course wise also you can take it. Yeah. Even I have seen, Balwinder, some institutions have taken even this semester wise each course feedback also. They have taken twice, one in the middle of the course, other one at the end of the course. So why, I asked them, why did you take it? Sir, if I take it at the end of the course only, I can implement this for the next only, right? But if I take it in the middle, at least I get some feedback that where I have to improve. Where I have, as a faculty, as a department, where I have to improve. You can take, but the work will increase. Because once you take it, you have to analyze it. Once you analyze it, you have to take corrective action. Once you take corrective action, then you have to see the impact of it. So it's good. But sometimes in the beginning, if you want to do all these things, it's very difficult. So first time when you are doing it, let you have one feedback only once in a year or once in a semester for all the things. Then try to slowly add up the things. So that faculty should not feel as a burden, right? So slowly you should progress it. Slowly you should, and then you should try to develop some online system so that every time faculty is not burdened, right? Students are filling it online and then you take it online and then analyze it using some tools and then you can do it. Otherwise it becomes a burdensome exercise for the faculty and the department.
Excuse me, sir. One more question, sir. Sorry, sir.
Yes, Rajkumar ji. Can you increase your volume, please?
Yes, sir. Is it MBA accreditation? Is it compulsory for every institute, sir? Is it compulsory? Or if you don't get the MBA accreditation, so what is the consequence, sir?
Yes. Very, very good question, Rajkumar ji.
Thank you, sir.
Consequence I will tell you. One is, when you look at the AICT approval process handbook,
Yes, sir.
If you want to start a new program, let us say in your diploma institute,
sir.
No new program you can start unless until one program is accredited. Suppose say in your Telangana state, in your polytechnic, one program is accredited, let us say for 3 years only, let us no problem. Sir. So if you want to start a new program, you are allowed to start one new program because you are one sir. Program is accredited. Okay, that is number one. Number two is in the existing program, you want to increase the approved intake. Right. If sir. The program is not accredited, you will not be allowed to go for the increase in intake also.
Sir.
This is number two. Number three is if the program, minimum number of programs are not accredited in your institute, you will not be allowed to participate in the funding from the AICT also. Right. For example, I'll give you one scheme. Right. Yes. So there is a monetization scheme. So it's my minimum criteria is at least 50% of your program should be accredited. Then only you are eligible to participate for the funding in the AICT monetization scheme. Otherwise, you are not allowed.
Yes, sir.
There are many constraints are there, Rajkumar ji. Many constraints.
Yes, sir. I understand.
And one more thing I'll tell you from the student point of view. There are many companies like TCS and Infosys and other companies, they are saying if your program is not accredited, they are not coming even for placements also. Very dangerous.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for valuable information, sir.
Thank you, Rajkumar ji. Any other questions?
I think you have answered, sir, all the queries. So thank you very much for your generous time for this question answer session also, although we have taken beyond the time which we have requested you. So, sir, thank you very much for interesting and informative session.